I want to say the best I would hope for you know reducing from FP32 to FP16 is something like 50% of sevens or 2x speed up, depending on how you do the calculation. I'm coming up with that number and also kind of validated by the previous speaker slide. But I'm coming up with this number with some assumptions. I'm going to assume that for this application, the we're memory bound. I'm further going to assume that flop.free, based on you know two evidences. One is how the pipeline works, and two is how the gap between the memory speed and the processor speed. I'm assuming that's large enough. So I'm going to neglect the floating point operation cost in terms of you know how much time you need to spend on that. So the only thing that I'm going to count is memory operation. And I'm also going to assume that our memory, the simulation is large enough that we have to stream the data from my memory to cache and to register for the processor to process. So so essentially, I'm only concerning about this streaming cost. And by reducing from FP32 to FP16, so essentially we reduce from 4 bytes per number to 2 bytes per number. So that's how I come up with the 50% of 7. This is in terms of time. And in terms of energy, I think it's a similar story. You might be able to argue a little bit more or less than that, but that's what we're hoping for. But yeah, before we go further, I want to caution you that there are where we do a lot of GPU programming, at least on GPU programming, there are some kind of overhead, you know, fixed overhead regardless of the precision that you use. For instance, if you have a large enough domain, you probably need to you probably want to use long int just to you know address the individual numbers, and that's a fixed overhead. And I think with some engineering effort, you can remove a lot of them, but some of them will remain. So I would say 50% is a good goal, and I was really happy to see the previous speakers that were actually able to you know achieve beyond that. Okay, so this is the background. This is not the message that I want to convey, but I want to make sure that we're on the same page. So there are, roughly speaking, where I know three different types of errors. One is the error in your data, in your input data. You folks probably know a lot about it. I know nothing about it. I'm not going to talk about that. There's still two other types of errors. One is called a discretization error. This is what happens when you try to discretize a continuous partial differential equation with, let's say, finite element or finite difference. You will introduce some discretization error. This is before you move to the machine, actually. And then there's a third error that is a runoff error, which will be the focus of the talk, but I want to make sure that, so this slide is really about the discretization error. When you don't have a, let's say, perfect discretization for the web problem, you might have this kind of behavior where you have a mode that, unphysical mode that is growing. And if you take a deep dive of the problem, so I'm taking the propagation matrix and the dual eigenvalue analysis. I'm plotting all the blue dots are the eigenvalues. So if I'm honoring the physics perfectly, they're all supposed to be on the imaginary axis, which means that all the eigenmodes are oscillatory. So that's the wave behavior. But if I don't have a good enough discretization, I might have some eigenvalues that just get perturbed slightly off the axis. I'm exaggerating in the x-axis here, so in reality it's much, much closer, but still enough to give you trouble. So the one on the left is not problematic because that's going to be oscillatory and decay, but the one on the right is what's going to give you this kind of problem. And it actually have this kind of predictive power that you know give you the rate of the, if you take the eigenvalue, you can kind of predict what's the rate of the growth, and it does match that. So, okay, one more thing is that this, as I mentioned earlier, this is on physical mode. This is not in our input data, not in the initial condition, not in the right-hand side, not in the short term. So what excited this is really runoff error. So think about it, if you have a zero to start with, you can amplify it with a large number, but if you keep multiplying zero with it, it's still going to remain zero. So what happens here is that we're not supposed to have this kind of mode, but because of runoff error, they get excited. So eventually we'll have this kind of growth. With FP64, the machine precision is 10 to minus 16, and with single is 10 to minus 8. So you have a lot of time before this kind of onset really happens. You might not even observe it in your simulation. But with FP16, this can happen a lot sooner because the runoff is 10 to minus 4. So I'm mentioning this because some of the colleagues asked me to give it a try. You know, because I was doing energy conserving discretization. Essentially, I was trying to force the eigenvalues to be on the imaginary axis. And that should eliminate this kind of problem. And some colleagues suggested to me, well, since you have done those kind of discretization, how about you try out FP16? My suspicion is that these colleagues might have the issue that were not, like, illustrated here, but not observed in FP64 or 32, because the starting point is so low. So you haven't got it to the point where you observe it, actually. So I give it a try. Okay, this is my first attempt. I have to tell you that I was really surprised. I feel it's really good. I was fully expecting it to just blow up, but it turns out, so this is the energy that I was plotting. You can see that for FP64 and 32 is pretty much constant, as I was expecting. But with FP16, I would actually have a decaying energy, which is not problematic. I have tried this with three different implementations, including one that is emulated in software. And I tried three different hardware that have genuine support for FP16 and also an emulated one. And I also tried multiple configurations. This energy loss has been a consistent behavior, except in one case where I tried to use stochastic rounding, where I don't see this kind of energy loss. This is just a side note, but I actually think that this kind of behavior, we might be able to, you know, mathematically prove that. Well, it's just a hypothesis, but I've seen it enough that I have the suspicion that, you know, this might be what we should expect. But so that's. Nevertheless, this is one thing that I was not very happy about. Another thing I was not very happy about is the small wiggles. So I tried something which is a very simple fix, and I got this result. I will explain to you what 3-op means later. So some of you might be, you know, thinking, and this is also my first thought, that I must have done a dumb mistake when I do the plotting. I must have plotted the same data 3 times. So I checked my plotting script, it seems fine, and eventually I zoomed in really hard, like 50 times or something like that. I see this kind of difference, and also I see this kind of characteristic behavior with FP16, where you have this kind of staircase behavior, and then I figured, okay, maybe we're onto something. It's not a, you know, dumb mistake that I made. So this is a simple fix. Solving this acoustic wave equation, this is algorithm on the left. I mean, there are, let's say, there are 100 different ways to skin a cat or something. I'm just presenting you one way of writing the algorithm that I consider the easiest to illustrate where I do the fix. The fix is in the sum, actually. When we so let me go through the line 1, 2, 3, what we're doing. Line 1, I'm essentially doing a stencil application. I didn't write it out. Line 2, I take care of the parameter. Line 3, I add whatever my right-hand side is to my solution. This is a time-stepping side. So what needs to be fixed is line 3, line 6, and line 11. And the fix is that instead of using the standard floating point sum, I'm going to use something called a compensated sum. There are two versions of that. One is called this one takes 3 operations. Essentially, what this does is that it takes 2 floating point number A and B. It will return 2 floating point number as output. S is a floating point sum, and T is the difference between the floating point sum and the exact sum. So if you think about it, it's quite amazing that you know, given 2 floating point number, the difference between the exact sum and the floating point sum can actually be represented by a floating point number. But, you know, that's well, we get more than that. We have a constructed way to, you know, actually retrieve that number. So if I you know, briefly explain to you what lines 5, 6, 7 is doing here. So when you, I'm going to assume that the so for this one to work, we need the exponent of A to be bigger than the exponent of B. But in binary, this is equivalent to say that A is bigger than B in magnitude. So if that's the case, and when we add a small number b to a, the first thing that we do is to shift we need to shift the number so that the floating point would align. So what happens, and then you sum the number, and then you run it down. So what happens is that the lower part of b gets shifted and they run it off. So the floating point S actually only stores the sum of A and the higher part of B. And then line six, what we do is that we subtract A from that. So we recover the higher part of B in zeta. And in line seven, what we do is that we subtract the higher part of B from B itself to recover the lower part of B. So that's what we lost in line five. So that's how you keep track of what gets lost in the sum. And then I just, you know, this is updated algorithm. Instead of a sum, standard sum, I use the compensated sum. And then for whatever is left in my, for whatever that was lost, I added it to the next time step. And that seems to fix the problem. I know some of you might be suspicious that in this line you have a stencil application. You have a stencil application. That's a lot of floating point operations. You have multiplication. You have sum, and here you potentially even have a division. While this is just a one floating point operation, and it's a simple sum. You know, you probably just 10%, 20%, or even less of the entire floating point operation that you're doing. How come if you just address this simple place, you can address the whole thing? I was suspicious about that as well, but this is one experiment where I did a simulation with promotion. So what I mean is that my fundamental, my working precision is still FP16, but when I do the stencil application, I promote everything to FP64. But then when I do the sum, I don't keep track of the lost bits. So the stencil application is accurate, but the sum is not. You can see that you still have the same problem as before. Add back to the compensation, we get a good result again. I don't have the full analysis written down in longhand just yet, but here's the one model problem. I think it suffices to maybe inspire some hope on or some basic understanding on why this might be the case. So this model problem is really to just calculate the inner product of two vectors. And so now, assuming both vectors are length n, and what we have is n multiplication and n minus 1 summation. I'm doing it in this kind of very, the basic procedure that would emulate the behavior of time stepping update in our web simulation. And I'm going to make the standard assumption that with floating point multiplication, I will introduce an error that is epsilon. And with floating point sum, I will introduce a relative error that is delta. And don't worry about this part, but this Sn is the end result. And this is what I get on the computer. You can see that the error epsilon and the delta that show up differently. The delta compound, but epsilon does not. The error from multiplication has a less impact in the final error than the error from the sum. So I guess I don't want to make it mystical, but I think the message is that I think committing error is fine. Committing runoff error is totally fine. We do that all the time. What can really be problematic is how this error gets carried forward in time. So for that to for runoff error to really cause havoc, you need a long sequence of operation for that to give it a chance to do that. The sum here and also the sum in our web simulation, that is a long sequence of operation where you have this kind of compounding behavior, while the multiplication here is not. Now this does not entirely apply to the time updating that I was showing earlier because we have feedback. It's more complicated, but I think it's following the same one. To explain the behavior. Okay, so that was acoustic equation. So I also tried this on elastic equation with some kind of heterogeneous medium and different type of boundary condition. Sorry, I think it checks out. You still see this kind of improvement. And one more thing is that I could be fooling myself, right? I could be think I'm doing FP16, but the compiler and the runtime, they just executed on FP64 hardware. So I have to do some kind of profiling to validate that claim. So on the top row is memory streamed And I did some calculation that essentially reduced to 6 bytes so 6 bytes per 3 numbers, so 2 bytes per number. So that's what I was expecting. Same for the float and the double. And you see also the only operation that gets carried out, a floating point operation that gets carried out, is the half precision one. This one needs a little bit of explanation. They show up in the float and the double, but I think it's because NVIDIA hardware, the FMA pipeline, also performs integer operation. So that's why we see a little bit over there. So the real number here should be like 2, 2, 3, 7, 5, add, subtract that number. At least I don't see anything there. So that's a good validation for me. Some caveats. At the beginning, I told you that there are two types of errors that I wanted to distinguish. One is the discretization error, and the other is runoff error. But unfortunately, you can't quite distinguish them. So I was doing my best trying to, you know, focus the effort on addressing the runoff error that coming up in a particular way that is, you know, showing up in the course of the simulation as an accumulation that becomes problematic eventually. But there are different ways for the runoff error to give you problem. Once these two pictures are really showing that the runoff error can induce a discretization error. They can, because of runoff error, you can have a discretization operator that is not as good as you were hoping for. And I don't think you might particularly care about this case, but I just want to show that this can happen. This is the point prevalence at 110. So this is like much finer than most of the folks would use. But you do said, I want to push the delta X to be very small and see what, you know, maybe some bad things might happen. And you do see some kind of oscillatory, you know, modes started popping up. And another thing is that sometimes you can have fast shift. This doesn't happen until very late, like 100 seconds. We probably don't care either, but I just want to, you know, show you that it can happen. A few more caveats. One is, you know, I showed you the algorithm, you know, about reducing from FP32 to FP16. I claimed that, you know, we can reduce the bytes per number from 4 to 2, but then I have to use a compensation storage. You would need to find a place to hide those compensation storage. I happen to find one in the right-hand side that's, you know, depends on how I write the code, and depending on the time-stepping scheme that I was using, I don't know whether or not you can find it. I hope you can, and that's one caveat. Another one is you have to be very careful with compiler optimization. The compensated sum, if you're using very aggressive compiler optimization, that can be optimized away. So you're essentially, even if you write down those compensated sum, what happens on, you know, the compiler can, you know, decide to just boil that down to a simple, the standard floating point operation. So that can be problematic as well. So with that,